Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu newspaper analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 12th of November 2021. So these are the list of news articles chosen for today's discussion. Now, without wasting much time, let us get into the news article discussion. Let us take up this editorial article. See, on the evening of Diwali, the government lowered excise duty on both petrol and diesel. While the duty on petrol was reduced by 5 rupees, the duty on diesel was reduced by 10 rupees. See, this duty reduction is said to be dedicated to farmers for keeping the economic growth momentum up even during the COVID-19 lockdown phase. Apart from this, it is also expected that this cut would also serve as a boost to farmers throughout the upcoming rabi season. So, this editorial is written in this context, and the question of whether these changes actually favor the ordinary people or not is the subject of this discussion. The syllabus relevant to this article is highlighted here for your reference. Please go through it. First, let us understand what is surcharge. See, a surcharge or additional charge is essentially a tax levied on a tax. See, it is calculated on payable tax and it is not calculated on income generated. So, make a note of this major difference. It is calculated on payable tax. To understand this clearly, let us take an example. See, if a tax is imposed at 30% on an income of rupees 100, that is, if your income is 100 rupees and 30% of 100 rupees is imposed as a tax, the total payable tax would be rupees 30, right? Then a surcharge of 10% calculated on 30 rupees would amount to rupees 3. And this 3 rupees is the surcharge you have to pay. So it is clear that surcharge is nothing but tax levied on a tax. So the total amount of tax that you have to pay is 33 rupees. So with this understanding, now let us understand the pricing of petrol and diesel. Now look at this table. Let us take up the figures in the table as an example. This table depicts the price of the petrol and diesel, and the price of petrol and diesel is broken down and the price of each component is displayed here. If you can see in this image, the excise duty levied by center alone constitute 34%. The excise duty is further broken into basic tax and cession surcharge, which is levied by center. In the second figure also, you can see that in the February 2021 column, the excise duty levied by the center is 96%, which is 8 or 9 times higher than the basic tax. Here you can see the basic tax is just 4%. The remaining 96% is cession surcharge. See, the constitution do allow the center to levy cess and surcharge beyond the basic taxes and duties in extraordinary situations. But as per the author, levying cess and surcharge manifold higher than the basic taxes is nothing but a misuse of such provisions of the constitution. Apart from this, the author also states that these additional taxes does not go to the divisible pool. As a result, such a high burden of tax is an attack on the people and the federal right of the state. Now, let us understand this further. See, those central taxes like excise duty are levied by the center, it has only 59% of the revenue from these taxes. That is, in 100%, only 59% will be given to the center. The remaining 41% of the revenue is required to be devolved to the state government as per the recommendations of the 15th Finance Commission. And just know that these devolved tax are untied in nature. That is, the state can spend them according to their own discretion. As I already said, the excise duty levied on petrol and diesel consists of two broad components, which is the basic excise duty or basic tax and the cess and surcharge component. Of this, only the revenue generated from the tax component is devolved to the state. Revenue generated by the center from any cess or surcharge is not devolved to the state. So apart from this, currently the agricultural infrastructure and development cess and road and infrastructure cess are also levied on the sale of petrol and diesel in addition to the surcharges levied by the center. Even this will not devolve to the state government and it will not contribute to the divisible pool. See, the new tax and cess have brought in thousands of crores of rupees for the government. Even in the midst of a pandemic, the center might have collected lakhs of thousands of rupees through these taxes. But the cess and surcharges collected neither reached the needy nor did contribute to the divisible pool. If that is the case, then where has this money gone and who has received the benefits of this money is the question here. Answering these questions will reveal the true nature of states and centers issue. See, as per the author, a handful of corporate houses are the beneficiaries here. See, the center waived corporate loans worth rupees 8.75 lakh crores after calculating the value of public wealth to be monetized at rupees 6 lakh crores. Now, at the expense of public funds deposited mostly in public sector banks, a bad bank will take care of the non-performing assets created by these corporations. On the other hand, public wealth is being given over to corporate houses while the debt of these businesses is being paid by the center with public funds. See, in the previous fiscal year alone, almost 1 lakh crore rupees of corporate taxes were also avoided. This tax breaks offered to corporations not only affected the center but also affected the state. It resulted in significant revenue loss for both the center and it did not contribute any rupees to divisible pool. And as per the author, to compensate this loss, the government is taking advantage of people during a pandemic by imposing high possible taxes on petrol and diesel. See, the revenue that would have aided individuals in the event of a pandemic are going to a collection of business companies. This is what the author tries to convey here. So with this, we came to the end of this news article discussion. In this news article discussion, we saw about what is a surcharge. We understood the pricing of petrol and diesel. And we saw some of the important points mentioned in the editorial. See, these are the opinions of the author. You can take these points or leave it. It is your discretion, but this editorial will help you to know the other side of the coin. So now let us move on to the next news article discussion. Now our discussion is going to be based on this advertisement. See, this advertisement highlights RBI's two innovative and customer-centric initiatives. See, these schemes will be launched by our Prime Minister today. So from our exam perspective, let us see about these schemes now. So to begin with, first let us know about RBI Retail Direct scheme. See, the aim of this scheme is to enhance the access of retail investors to the government securities market. Now you can get a doubt that who is a retail investor? See, a retail investor, who is also known as an individual investor, is a non-professional investor who buys and sells securities that contain a basket of securities such as mutual funds and ETFs. That is, pretty much every person who buys and sells debt, equity or other investments through a broker, bank, real estate agent and so on are called as retail investors. So anybody can be a retail investor, even you and me can be a retail investor. So what does this scheme offer? See, the scheme offers the retail investors a new avenue for directly investing in securities which are issued by the government of India and state government. We are not going to see about this scheme for today because we have covered the scheme in detail on July 13th Hindu newspaper analysis. Interested viewers can go through it. It will be very helpful for your prelims and mains examination. So now we are going to see about the next scheme called Reserve Bank Integrated Ombudsman Scheme, that is RBIOS. First, what ombudsman means? See, it refers to an official who is appointed to investigate complaints of individuals against a company or organization or a public authority. So, ombudsman is an officer or an official who is appointed to investigate complaints of individuals against whom a company or organization or a public authority. So we can say ombudsman is the grievance redressal officer or a grievance redressal system. Now who can have ombudsman? See, major public sectors may have ombudsman. For example, in banking, we have the banking ombudsman who is a senior official appointed by the Reserve Bank of India. This banking ombudsman redresses the complaints of customers that was against the deficiency in certain banking services. These banking services includes non-payments or inordinate delay in the payment of checks, etc. See, these services are specified in Clause 8 of the Banking Ombudsman Scheme 2006. So, any person or any customer can raise complaints on these banking services. So, for banking, we have this scheme. So, to put it in simple words, such ombudsman schemes are redressal systems on financial matters. Similarly, RBI has separate ombudsman scheme for non-banking financial companies, that is NBFCs, and for digital transactions as well. The names of the schemes are Ombudsman Scheme for NBFCs that was launched in 2018 and the Ombudsman Scheme for Digital Transactions which was launched in 2019. And now with the new scheme of RBIOS, that is Reserve Bank Integrated Ombudsman Scheme, RBI is adopting a one nation, one ombudsman approach. And for this, RBI is merging the above three of its own ombudsman scheme into one. That means from now on, for all customers of RBI regulated entities such as banking, NBFCs and for other digital transactions, there will be a single redressal system. So, through the scheme, RBI aims to further improve the grievance redressal mechanism for resolving customers' complaints against the entity regulated by it. As simple as that. Now, let us see some of the features of the scheme. Important features of the scheme includes, it will have one portal, one email and one address for the customers to lodge their complaints. There will be a single point of reference for customers to file their complaints, and this single point of reference will be used to submit the documents, track status and provide feedbacks as well. Along with this, a multilingual toll-free number will be provided to get all relevant information on grievance redressal and assistance for filing complaints. So these are some of the important features of the scheme which you have to make a note of. So the overall benefits of the scheme are, first, the customer can file their complaint from anywhere at any time. Second, it eliminates the need to identify any specific ombudsman or scheme. Third, the new scheme removes the jurisdictional limitation and limited grounds for complaint. So these are some of the overall benefits of the scheme that you have to make a note of. So in this discussion, we saw about two important innovative and customer-centric initiatives by RBI. First, we saw about RBI Retail Direct Scheme. We saw who is a retail investor. Next, we saw about Reserve Bank Integrated Ombudsman Scheme. We saw who is an ombudsman and what is his role. And we also saw some of the features of the scheme and we saw overall benefits of the scheme as well. With this, we came to the end of this news article discussion. Now, let us move on to the next news article discussion. Now, for our next discussion, let us take up this news article. See, this news article mentions about the numbers of the Nilgiri Thar and it also reports that the numbers of these species are stable and rising. See, this is based on the survey conducted by the World Wide Fund for Nature, that is WWF India. So in this context, let us see about this species as it is quite important from exam perspective. Now, let us know some of the important points about Nilgiri Thar first. See, Nilgiri Thar is a mountain ungulate species. See, ungulate is the term applied to any hoofed mammal. Any mammal which are hoofed are called ungulate. Hooves are nothing but the tip of a toe of an ungulate mammal, which is unique for these kinds of species. And in India, we have 12 mountain ungulate species, but Nilgiri Thar is the only mountain ungulate species in southern India. So it is a very important point to note here. Nilgiri Thar is the only mountain ungulate species in the southern India, while India have 12 mountain ungulate species. And very important point to note here is that Nilgiri tar is an endemic species of the Western Ghats. Note that it is also the state animal of Tamil Nadu. Now coming to its distribution, here you should note that previously it was found along the entire stretch of Western Ghats. But now it is found only in small fragmented pockets of Western Ghats. See, according to a population estimation by WWF in 2015, Nilgiri tar's population has been estimated at 3,122 individuals in the wild. And currently, its distribution is along a narrow stretch of 400 kilometers in the Western Ghats. And this stretch is between the Nilgiris in the north and Kanyakumari hills in the south of the region. If you can see, this stretch falls in the states of Kerala and Tamil Nadu, and that means a large part of its population have been wiped out from its historical range. And even the existing population are under the severe stress due to many threats. So this is the current situation of the Nilgiri tar's population. And according to the survey, smaller population are also found in Palani Hills, Sri Velliputtur Range, the Meghamalai and Agastyar Ranges. These points are very important to note because UPSC may twist a question and ask on these kinds of facts. Now, only two large populations are documented so far. One is present in the Nilgiris and other is from the Annamalai Hills in Kerala. Here, note that Ervikulam National Park in Annamalai Hills is home to the largest population of the Nilgiri tar. It has more than 700 individuals. So, with this information, now let us see some of its important characteristics features. See, its preferred habitat is grasslands with steep rocky cliff shelters. So it is found in the open mountain grassland habitats of southern Western Ghats at elevations from 1200 to 2600 meters. So they prefer grasslands with steep rocky cliffs, and they are found in open mountain grassland habitats of southern Western Ghats at an elevation from 1200 to 2600 meters. See, it is the only tar adapted to a cold and wet tropical environment, and it is diurnal in nature. That is, they are active in the daytime. So now moving on, what are the threats faced by this species? See, the first threat is hunting. See, the Nilgiri tars are occasionally hunted for its meat and skin, and it poses a very dangerous threat to the species. Second is habitat loss. See, habitat loss is happening due to the other factors such as rampant deforestation, competition with domestic livestock, hydroelectric projects in Nilgiri tar habitat, and monoculture plantations. The issue does not stop there. The habitat loss leads to extreme habitat fragmentation, which leads to population decline. So, because of these threats, many conservation efforts have been taken, like it is protected under Schedule 1, Part 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of India, that is the WPA Act of 1972, and it is also listed as endangered in the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. So in this discussion, we saw about Nilgiri tar, we saw about its distribution, we also discussed about an evidence of population decline, and we saw about the characteristic features of the Nilgiri tars. Along with that, we saw some of the dangerous threats faced by this species, and we saw about the protection status under WPA Act and IUCN Red List. So with this idea in mind, now let us move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this news article for our next discussion. See, the news article talks about India's five-fold plan on reducing the carbon intensity, and it also talks about the demand of $1 trillion by India to adapt to the climate change. First of all, let us see about India's five-fold plan. See, at the 26th Conference of Parties, that is the COP26, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi declared a five-fold strategy. It is termed as the Panchamrita to achieve net zero emission by 2070. See, the ultimate goal of this fivefold plan is to achieve net zero emission by 2070. Now, you may get a doubt about what is this net zero emission. See, net zero means achieving a balance between the greenhouse gases put into the atmosphere and those taken out from the atmosphere. So, it is nothing but striking a balance between the greenhouse gases put into the atmosphere and taken out of the atmosphere. So, achieving zero emission means releasing no greenhouse gas to the atmosphere. That is, no carbon dioxide, no methane, no nitrous oxide or other greenhouse gases are emitted into the atmosphere. And very important point to note here is that achieving net zero emission means that some greenhouse gases are still released, but these are countered or balanced by removing an equivalent amount of greenhouse gases from the atmosphere and storing it permanently in soil, plants or materials. So achieving zero emission does not mean that completely eliminating the release of greenhouse gases. It just means striking a balance between greenhouse gases put into the atmosphere and taken out of the atmosphere. And in 26th Conference of Parties, our Indian Prime Minister declared a five-fold strategy, which was termed as the Panchamitra, to achieve net zero emission by 2070. So let us see about the five-fold path one by one. The first plan is to achieve non-fossil energy capacity by 2030. See, India will get its non-fossil energy capacity to 500 gigawatts by 2030, and Central Electricity Authority projects that India's installed capacity of non-fossil energy in 2019 was 134 gigawatt, and by 2030 it will be 522 gigawatt, thereby achieving the target. So the first plan is to achieve the non-fossil energy capacity. Know that the Central Electricity Authority of India advises the government on policy matters and formulates plans for the development of electricity systems. It is a statutory organization, and this CEA reports that India will get its non-fossil energy capacity to 500 gigawatts by 2030. Now, the second plan is to achieve energy requirements from renewable energy by 2030. See, India will meet 50% of its energy requirement from renewable energy by 2030, and according to the CEA, renewable energy capacity by 2021 is 12%, and to meet 50% of energy requirements, installed capacity should be increased to 700 gigawatts. So this is the second fold path, or the second target, that is, India have to meet 50% of its energy requirement from renewable energy by 2030. Now, moving on to the third important plan. See, India will reduce the total projected carbon emission by 1 billion tons from now onwards till 2030. An important point to note here is that India's CO2 emission in 2021 is 2.88 gigatons, and the Center for Science and Environment projects that India's emission in 2030 as 4.48 gigatons. And according to this target, India will cut its carbon emission by 1 billion tons, and the emission in 2030 will be 3.48 gigatons. Now, moving on to the fourth path. See, by 2030, India will reduce the carbon intensity of its economy by less than 45%. And according to the CSE, India has achieved 25% of emission intensity reduction between 2005 to 2016, and is on the path to achieve more than 40% by 2030. So the fourth plan is to reduce the carbon intensity of its economy by less than 45% by 2030. Now, moving on to the fifth plan. So by doing all the fourfold plans which I mentioned earlier, India plans to achieve the target of net zero by the year 2070. Now, let us see why India demanded for $1 trillion to adapt and mitigate the challenges. See, this demand is justified because it is the third highest polluter in 2019. See, India has a huge need to grow economy and to meet the energy needs of millions of people. So, to strike a balance between the two, India demanded for this $1 trillion. And it is justified because India cannot let anyone down. So in this discussion, we saw about India's five-fold plan to achieve net zero emission by 2070. We saw what is net zero, and we briefly discussed about the five-fold plan. So with these informations in mind, now let us move on to the next segment of the news article discussion. Now let us see some of the prelims practice questions. See, now look at this first question. This question is about Ombudsman scheme. Recently, RBI launched an innovative and customer-centric scheme, Reserve Bank Integrated Ombudsman Scheme. Which of the following statement have been merged under this scheme? Statement 1, Banking Ombudsman Scheme 2006. Statement 2, Ombudsman Scheme for Non-Banking Financial Companies 2018. And Statement 3, Ombudsman Scheme for Digital Transactions 2019. Select the correct answer from the codes given below. Option A, 1 and 2 only. Option B, 2 and 3 only. Option C, 1 and 3 only. And Option D, 1, 2 and 3. So in our discussion itself, we saw that all the three schemes will be integrated. And the main purpose of this new scheme is to adopt a one nation, one ombudsman approach. Here, the RBI is merging all the three of its own ombudsman scheme into one. That means from now on, for all customers of RBI regulated entities such as banks, NBFCs, there will be a single redressal system. So even if you don't know the name of the scheme, if you can understand this concept, you can easily arrive at the answer. So the correct answer for the question is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Now moving on to the next question. This question is about Nilgiri Tar. Other than poaching, what are the possible reasons for the decline in the population of Nilgiri Tar? First statement, monoculture plantation. Second statement, competition with domestic livestock. Third statement, hydroelectric projects. Fourth statement, use of synthetic fertilizers and other agricultural chemicals in crop fields. Select the correct answer from the codes given below. Option A, 1 and 4 only. Option B, 1, 2 and 3 only. Option C, 2, 3 and 4 only. And Option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4 only. See, in our discussion, we saw that hunting is the major threat faced by this species. Followed by that, we saw that habitat loss due to rampant deforestation, competition with domestic livestock, hydroelectric projects and monoculture plantations are posing threats to the species. Apart from that, extreme habitat fragmentation have also posed threat to the species. So the answer should not have statement 4. If you eliminate statement 4, you can directly arrive at the answer. That is 1, 2 and 3 only. So the correct option for the question is option B, 1, 2 and 3 only. Now moving on to the next question. See, this question is about the COP26. Consider the following statements. First statement, India declared five-fold statement termed as Panchamitra in Glasgow Climate Conference of UNFCCC. Second statement, India has committed to net zero emission by the year 2050. You have to choose the correct option using the codes given below. Option A, 1 only. Option B, 2 only. Option C, both 1 and 2. And Option D, neither 1 nor 2. See, statement 1 is correct because at the 26th Conference of Parties of UNFCCC, which held at Glasgow, our Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi declared a five-fold strategy termed as the Panchamitra. We saw about the 5 points in our discussion. So the first statement is correct. Now moving on to the next statement. We saw that India has committed to achieve net zero emission by the year 2070. It is not 2050. So the second statement is incorrect. So the correct answer for the question is option A, 1 only. With this, main questions are displayed here. Interested aspirants can write the answer and post it in the comment section. With this, we came to the end of the news article discussion. If you like the video, like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel. Thank you.